In the name of Allah, our Creator, the Creator of the universe and of everything that's in it, I greet you all, dear audience, in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, blessings, and mercy be with you all. We are still discussing the issue of scientific notions in the glorious Quran. And we have been reiterating that the glorious Quran is basically a book of guidance to man in areas that cannot be clearly addressed by man, such as the area of faith, the area of acts of worship, the area of the moral code, and the area of the code of transactions with others. These four basic areas were revealed to Adam and Eve on the moment of their creation, and they were also revealed to a large number of prophets and messengers, and there had been an end to that long chain of divine guidance to man, and the end was the coming of the seal of prophethood, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Because his message is the final form of divine guidance to man, our Creator has taken the responsibility to preserve it in its entirety in exactly the same language of revelation it came with, the Arabic language, and it was preserved in full in the glorious Quran and in the traditions of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. The Quran being the word of the Creator in its divine purity, preserved in exactly the same language of revelation. Every single letter in it is absolutely correct. Every single word, every single verse is absolutely correct because the Quran is the divine word and its divine purity. And who would know the creation other than the Creator or better than the Creator himself? Because of this, every single scientific notion that comes within the main message of the Quran has to be absolutely correct. We also mentioned that these scientific notions did not come to us as pieces of scientific information per se. They come in the context of testifying to the might, knowledge, wisdom, and power of the Creator, to testify to the fact that inasmuch as He has created everything out of nothingness, He is capable of annihilating everything to nothingness and then resurrecting everything again. And the area of resurrection has been highly debated by unbelievers and agnostics throughout time. Because unless you understand the concept of divinity, you will feel that it is practically impossible for any flesh body that decays and goes back to the dust of the soil to come back into existence. But because of this, we say that the basic issue in Islam is believing in the supreme power, the supreme being who has created everything and who is capable of annihilating everything and resurrecting everything again. Because of this, we say that man, in his knowledge, has got two sources. The first source is the revealed knowledge, the divine guidance from our Creator to man in areas that cannot be clearly addressed by man. And the second source of the human knowledge is the acquired knowledge. Both sources have to integrate for the betterment of life on earth. We can never ever live with one of the sources and do without the other. Because acquired knowledge can help man to be a good vicegerent on earth. And the revealed knowledge can let man understand his or her true message in this world as a worshiper to a great Creator who has created us with a purpose. And this purpose is dual: to worship the Creator in the way He has prescribed and to be a good vicegerent on earth. But to worship the Creator, you have to know His guidance. And to be a good vicegerent on earth, you have to really work hard to acquire knowledge and apply that knowledge for the betterment of life on earth. Because of this, whenever one of these two sources of human knowledge can overcome the other, life becomes unbalanced. And that's why every sane person is asked to have a balanced stand, having from the revealed knowledge, whatever he or she needs for understanding his or her message in life, and having from the acquired knowledge what can help him or her to be a good vicegerent on earth. Because of this, we believe that understanding the cosmic verses in the glorious Quran and in the sayings of Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the light of the latest discovered scientific facts, can help Muslims to understand these verses in a better way, and can prove to Muslims and non-Muslims alike the precedence of the Quran with an immense quantity of scientific information that was not possible to be known at the time of the revelation of the Quran or for many centuries after the time of revelation. This scientific precedence of the Quran with an immense quantity of scientific facts is what we call the scientific miraculous nature of the glorious Quran. And this, besides being a great help to Muslims to understand the Quran in a better way and to live with the Quran at their present time, it is an excellent means of da'wah, an excellent way of carrying the message of Islam to as many people as we can in our time, this time when man has reached a great deal of scientific knowledge and has succeeded in applying that knowledge in many technologies. And because of this, I do believe that the cosmic verses in the glorious Quran are an address to the people of our time, to talk to them in the only language they can accept and they can understand during the era of science and technology we are living in. One of these scientific notions is the description of earthquakes in the glorious Quran. And one would wonder, the Quran is basically a book of guidance to man in areas of faith, areas of acts of worship, the moral code, and the code of transactions with others. Why should the Quran speak about earthquakes? Really, in the material world we are living in, man tends to understand that every natural phenomenon has got its basic roots that can be understood by man. And due to the negation of religion, due to the materialistic attitude of the current civilization, man tends to think that any of these natural phenomena has got its own natural causes. And we do not need to indulge into some philosophical understandings of these natural phenomena. One of the most severe, actually, natural phenomena of our time is earthquakes. And the gravest things about earthquakes is its suddenness. An earthquake can take place in a few seconds, and the toll of losses are beyond imagination. At the beginning of the 20th century, an earthquake happened in China and did not take more than half a minute, and the death toll was more than 750,000 souls, human beings. So really, it's one of the gravest disasters we can witness in our life on the surface of that planet. The Quran tells us that most of these natural catastrophes and disasters are actually the net product of the misbehavior of man. And Allah, who governs that universe, He is the sole power that can move one of these disasters towards striking certain people at a certain time, at a certain place, or relieve them from it. And this is the Islamic outlook, that every natural disaster is amidst the soldiers of the Creator. Allah can instruct these natural disasters to strike anywhere, at any time, and strike certain people as a punishment for ill-doers, and as a way of testing good ones, and a good reminder for those who can be saved after the disaster. Because of this, I choose to talk to you about the notion of earthquakes in the glorious Quran. The glorious Quran speaks about disasters that have struck people of the past, people who have plotted against the messengers of Allah, like the people of Thamud, the people of Lut, many of these old nations that rejected religion and stood in the face of messengers of Allah and tried to plot against the divine plan, Allah has punished them. And we can see clearly, reading through the Qur'an, that most of these natural disasters are actually a way of punishment from our Creator to ill-doers. And if some good individuals would be within the killed or the wounded or the affected by this disaster, it is actually a way of testing them. And those who would be saved completely should really use this as a good reminder to realize that everything in that universe is running according to a perfect plan by the Creator. None of these natural disasters can take place by itself, because these disasters, although we understand the mechanism of how they take place, or is not initiated by itself. Dear viewers, we'll take a short break and then we'll come back to you, inshallah, in a few moments to continue our discussion about the fact that none of these natural phenomena can take place on its own. Welcome back, dear viewers. Before this short break, I was reading to you the ayah number 26, the verse number 26 from Surah An-Nahl, the honeybee chapter in the Quran. And the verse emphasizes the fact that none of the natural phenomena that strike against people in our lifetime can take place except by the ill deeds of certain people. The verse reads, قَدْ مَكَرَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. People who came before the unbelievers and associators of Quraysh did plot against the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, did reject the divine message, did react negatively towards the divine messenger. And that's why Allah punished him. Inasmuch as he has punished the people of Thamud, the people of Lut, the people of Ad, the people of the Pharaoh, Allah punished many nations and left these different types of punishment as a lesson for people to learn. And the verse reads, قَدْ مَكَرَ الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِهِمْ. People who came before them did plot against the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَأَتَى اللَّهُ بُنْيَانَهُمْ مِنَ الْقَوَاعِدِ. Allah has taken their buildings from its foundations. فَخَرَّ عَلَيْهِمُ سَقْفُهُمْ فَوْقِهِمْ. The roof fell on top of them. وَأَتَاهُمُ الْعَذَابُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. And the divine punishment came to them from directions they never were aware of. This simple verse clearly emphasizes the fact that any natural phenomenon that strikes certain people at a certain time, this must be due to the ill deeds of these people. It comes as a punishment from the Creator to these ill doers. And one would say some of the innocent people may be caught amidst this catastrophe. That's true. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, may Allah's peace and blessing be with him, was asked, O Messenger of Allah, أَنَهْلَكُ وَفِينَ الصَّالِحُونَ. Are we subjected to punishment and we have some of the pious people amidst us? He said, yes, na'am. So really, whenever a natural phenomenon strikes, this must be the product of some ill deeds by certain people in the area that was struck by this natural phenomenon. And some pious people, some good people, may really be affected by this disaster, but Allah will reward them. And whoever would be saved must take this as a lesson to behave properly according to the divine guidance. We read in the same surah, Surah An-Nahl, we read a similar emphasis, actually shortly after this verse, after this ayah, we read, أَفَأَمِنَ الَّذِينَ مَكَرُوا السَّيِّئَاتِ أَنْ يَخْسِفَ اللَّهُ بِهِمُ الْأَرْضَ أَوْ يَأْتِيَهُمُ الْعَذَابُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. Those who would plot against the will of the Creator, Are they really secure that they will not be punished by the Creator? أَفَأَمِنَ الَّذِينَ مَكَرُوا السَّيِّئَاتِ أَنْ يَخْسِفَ اللَّهُ بِهُمُ الْأَرْضِ. Allah will cause the earth to swallow them. The earth would collapse under their own feet. أَنْ يَخْسِفَ اللَّهُ بِهُمُ الْأَرْضَ أَوْ يَأْتِيهُمُ الْعَذَابُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. Or the divine punishment can come to them from directions they never perceived, they never expected. أَفَأَمِنَ الَّذِينَ مَكَرُوا السَّيِّئَاتِ أَنْ يَخْسِفَ اللَّهُ بِهُمُ الْأَرْضَ أَوْ يَأْتِيهِمُ الْعَذَابُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ أَوْ يَأْخُذَهُمْ فِي تَقَلُّبِهِمْ فَمَا هُمْ بِمُعْجِزِينَ. Or that he may not call them to account in the midst of their goings to and fro without a chance of their frustrating him. أَوْ يَأْخُذَهُمْ فِي تَقَلُّبِهِمْ فَمَا هُمْ بِمُعْجِزِينَ. You cannot stand in the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah can impose his punishment while people are working, while people are going in and out. أو يأخذهم في تقلبهم فهم معجزين أو يأخذهم على تخوف فإن ربكم لرؤوف رحيم. Allah can take them, can punish them while they are actually waiting for that punishment by a process of slow wastage, for thy Lord is indeed full of kindness and mercy. أو يأخذهم على تخوف فإن ربكم لرؤوف رحيم. Then Allah can take them by surprise, or can take them while they are watching and expecting the punishment. Yet, people never learn up until our time, whenever an earthquake or a hurricane or a disease or fighting or any of these natural disasters can strike anywhere, people can claim that we understand the mechanism, how an earthquake can take place, how a volcanic eruption can take place, how a hurricane can take place. But they do not realize that none of us human beings can have any saying in the running of that earthquake or volcanic eruption or a hurricane or a tornado or anything of the like. This is run by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Quran on many, many occasions tells us clearly that nothing strikes the human beings without some ill deeds by the people in that area. And that's why Muslims are asked to watch themselves and not to accept any misbehavior in their community. Otherwise, the divine punishment can strike the good and the bad in no time. So the description, فَأَتَى اللَّهُ بُنْيَانَهُمْ مِنَ الْقَوَاعِدِ فَخَرَّ عَلَيْهِمُ سَقْفُهُمْ فَوْقِهِمْ وَأَتَاهُمُ الْعَذَابُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. This is the best description of how an earthquake can take a particular place. The seismic waves can strike, first of all, the foundations. And if foundations have been struck, then the whole building will definitely collapse. So I do believe that these two verses in Surah An-Nahl and many of the Quranic verses that are alike can teach us an important lesson, that any natural phenomenon that strikes anywhere in the world is the result of some ill deeds by certain people in that community. And that's why Muslims are asked to refrain from living in a corrupt society, are asked to refrain from joining in some ill deeds in their own community. Muslims are asked to invite always for the good deeds, for watching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for observing al-akhirah, the last hour, realizing that they will be questioned about their own deeds in this world. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is quoted to have said, لا تزول قدم عبد يوم القيامة حتى يسأل عن أربع, عن عمره فيما أفناه وعن شبابه فيما أبلاه وعن ماله من أين اكتسبه وفيما أنفقه وعن علمه فيما أفاد به. The two feet of an individual, of a human being, will not be let loose on the day of judgment until he has answered to four basic questions. His lifespan on earth, how did he spend? His youthfulness, how did he use or misuse? His wealth, how did he earn and spend? And his knowledge, how did he benefit or harm humanity with? So life on that planet is a great responsibility. All forms of punishment that came to previous nations. Some of them are recorded in the glorious Qur'an and in the traditions of Muhammad, peace be upon him, are actually lessons for us to learn from it and to realize clearly that ill deeds can account for a severe divine punishment in the form of any of the so-called natural phenomena. And one of these most serious natural phenomena is earthquakes that has been clearly spelled out in Surah An-Nahl and in many other surahs of the glorious Quran to give us the exact message that behave well, you will be saved from these natural disasters. Try to control your own behavior and feel your own responsibility about the span of living Allah has given you on the surface of that planet. You will be saved from many of these natural disasters. So the notion of earthquakes in the glorious Quran comes in two contexts, earthquakes in this world and earthquakes at the time of destruction of this universe. And I have discussed the first phase. The second phase, of course, is beyond discussion here because it will be something beyond the imagination of man. This is a reminder to all human beings to take their life seriously, to consider their existence in this world as a great responsibility, to try to observe the fact that Allah is recording every act we do, every word we utter, every action we take, every decision we commit ourselves to it, and we will be held responsible for every second of our existence on the surface of that planet. I hope that this message is clear and it will give the viewers the essence of that message. Man is a responsible being about his actions and deeds. He has to watch carefully because Allah is watching over him, is recording his actions and his deeds, and can reward him and punish him in this world, in as much as he will reward and punishment in the world to come. And for a coming episode, I leave you in peace with our Islamic salutation. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, blessing, and mercy be with you all.